I'm Tom Farr, Director of the Religious Freedom Project here at the Berkley Center for Religion, Peace, and World Affairs, and welcome to our book event today entitled, I believe, The Good Muslim and Religious Freedom, which is, I think, a very interesting and provocative title, which is what we try to do to engage interest. And from the attendance here today, I think this subject has an intrinsic interest, but I think it's a great title, too. And I'm delighted to see the variety as well as the number of people that we have with us today. I'm going to turn it over in just a minute to my colleague Karen Rupprecht, who will introduce our two guests, Professor Mona Siddiqui, who is, I'm proud to say, a member of our Religious Freedom Project Scholars Team at the University of Edinburgh in the United Kingdom, and Professor Emeritus Charles Butterworth at the University of Maryland here locally. This is promises to be an exciting afternoon, and we're delighted to welcome you here. Now, before we do that, however, to pay the bills, so to speak, I'd like to just say a word about the Religious Freedom Project and sincerely invite those of you who are not already part of our regular group, I see many of you are, but some of you perhaps don't know much about the Religious Freedom Project. I urge you to sign up and receive our newsletters, which are quarterly, and our much more regular announcements of events such as this one. The premise of the Religious Freedom Project is that religious freedom is important. How's that for a controversial statement? For individuals and for societies, and believe it or not, it is a very contested proposition. We have been in operation now for 2.5 years. We are nearing the end of our first 3-year period of operation, during which we have engaged this issue. What is religious freedom? Why is it important to individuals and societies? Why is it contested? What are the bases for contesting the importance of religious freedom? There are different ways of defining it. Different religious traditions define it in different ways. So just to pick one among many of the projects that we've had, we have an annotated bibliography, a source book that we are putting out on the sources of religious freedom in the 5 major world traditions. So we have done the one on Christianity. We are about to complete and put up the one on Judaism. Islam is not too far behind. Both of these the lady and the gentleman to my right, in fact, all three of them, both of the ladies and the gentleman to my right have assisted us in that project. We will have Buddhism and Hinduism up by the end of the year. So these are resources for scholars, for students, and just for people who are interested in knowing about what these traditions have said. They're jurists, they're philosophers, they're theologians, they're political leaders and religious leaders and so forth. Now, at the end of this 3 years, we're going to begin a second 3 years. In January of 2014, having spent a great deal of time talking about and discussing, having an extended conversation about what religious freedom is, what is its history, how is it defined, why is it so controversial, we're going to double down, in the words of my colleague Tim Shaw, on a couple of very specific but very important issues. Out there, as you may or may not know, there's some tantalizing evidence that there are high correlations between religious freedom on the one hand and things like societal flourishing, economic, political goods on the other. For example, the more religious freedom you have in a country, the more economic growth and economic freedom and development you're likely to have in that country. The more religious freedom you have in a country, the more likely it is, if it's trying to struggle with the issue of democracy, the more likely it is to be successful. Well, what, if anything, is due to the presence of religious freedom? As I say, there are high correlations out there. We're gonna bring together teams of scholars to look at these correlations over the next 3 years and ask the question, are there causal relationships? Our hypothesis is that there are. But we're going to do this in the right way. We're not going to start with the answers. We're going to start with the questions. And we invite you to join us. We will be having public events and some private events. We'll have it all on our website, and we hope you will partner with us as we move forward in what we think is an important and exciting venture. So With that, I'm going to turn it over to Karen Rupprecht, who is a very important and valued member of our team, who is going to moderate and introduce our guest today. If you'll excuse me for walking behind you, I'm going to get out of the way here. Okay.
Thank you very much, Dr. Farr. As Professor Farr mentioned, I'm Karen Rupprecht. I'm a graduate student here in the Department of Government at Georgetown and also a research assistant with the Religious Freedom Project. And one of the objectives of anyone who is studying religious freedom, of course, is to understand the religions much better. And to that end, of course, we are honored to have Professor Mona Siddiqui with us today to discuss The Good Muslim, Reflections on Classical Islamic Law and Theology. Which I recommend to all of you. Professor Siddiqui is a professor of Islamic and Interreligious Studies and also the assistant principal for Religion and Society, both at the University of Edinburgh. She researches classical Islamic law, contemporary law and ethics, as well as Christian-Muslim relations. She's also been awarded an OBE by the British Empire for her service to interfaith relations in Britain. So you can see that throughout the book. She has a chapter, especially, I think, the chapter on love, the language of love in the Quran and in Christianity, as well as various perspectives on evil. Dr. Siddiqui has the gift for being fluent across and among and within various traditions. She's also a member of the Commission on Scottish Devolution and the World Economic Forum's Global Agenda Council on Islamic and Western Dialogue. She is also a regular commentator in the media and BBC and elsewhere. And she's published widely and extensively, especially in the last few years, including the books, How to Read the Quran in 2007, Islam in 2010, The Good Muslim, which came out last year, and she has a recent book, Christians, Muslims, and Jesus, which came out in 2013. So we are very honored to have Professor Siddiqui with us today from Scotland. And our discussant today is Professor Charles Butterworth, who is Professor Emeritus of Political Philosophy from the University of Maryland, College Park, just over in Maryland. He has an extensive CV, and if we were to rehearse it now, I think it would take most of our afternoon, so I'll try to cover some highlights. He has been recognized at College Park as a distinguished scholar and teacher, and also for his mentorship. He's taught at, among others, University of Chicago, Harvard University, St. John's College here at Georgetown, Marmara University in Turkey, as well as several universities throughout France. Beyond that, he's lectured throughout North Africa and the Middle East. So chances are, if there's a university, he has received a degree from it, taught or lectured there. And he holds a PhD in political science from the University of Chicago, as well as a doctorate in philosophy from the University of Nancy, and has studied at the University of Ain Shams in Egypt and the University of Bordeaux, like I said. He specializes in medieval Arab and Islamic political philosophy and has published extensively on Averroes, Al-Farabi, Al-Razi, and also Maimonides, and has published various studies of different aspects of political philosophy throughout the ancient, medieval, and even modern periods, including critical editions of Rousseau and Fanon, because why limit oneself to one sector? So we're honored to have both of our guests today. Professor Siddiqui is going to begin with a discussion on her book, and after that, we'll open it up to a discussion between the two scholars, and finally, some questions from the audience.
Thank you. Thank you, Karen. Thank you, first of all, to all of you for coming in from the heat. And thank you to all my colleagues at the Berkley Center, Kyle and Tim and Tom, and everybody else for organizing this. It's a real honor to be having a book event organized for me, so thank you. And thank you to Charles for making the time to come. Let me just say why I wrote this book and the rationale for the actual format of the book. Those of you who haven't seen it, it's not a monograph. It's a series of 7 to 8 chapters linked by the theme of what I call discursive Islam. So the pre-modern world of Islamic thought, which was discursive and not what I would say has been the transition to a dogmatic Islam. And the interest for me is that my own background has been largely in Islamic law, in classical fiqh. And when I read classical fiqh texts, I realize that the scholars, jurists, were very reluctant to ever say, and so this is it, and this is the law, and this is what you must do, and this is what God says. In fact, very often they would end their text by saying, "This is what we think, and God knows best." And that sentiment, I think, has been eclipsed to some extent by contemporary discussions on Islam, which is far more, "We know what God says." So part of my thinking for writing the book is, where has that style of writing disappeared to? Why is it that we don't, when we look at fiqh texts, we look at them to just glean aspects of the law that we think we need to use to justify our current positions on things, rather than the discursive element of law, which was a way of debating about almost everything. The second thing is that it seems to me that Muslims don't really do theology. They do law, they do history, they do politics, they do, whether you're looking at classical tradition, the classical tradition does have some theologians, but contemporary scholars of Islam, both from the West and from the Islamic world, do confessional theology, but they don't do theology in a way of talking about issues related to God and how that can affect us today, how we can explore issues. Again, I would say a discursive element. So by that I mean not just to say, how did the classical tradition talk of God's justice, but what does it mean to say God is just? And how would a just God interact in the world today? What does it mean when we say God is compassionate? And so for me, this book ties to some extent both those kind of leanings for me. I think I'm probably a specialist in fiqh, but at heart a theologian. And I know that some people have issues with that. Theology has, for the most part, in the academy, been a largely Christian discipline. But I think we've lost something in the Islamic tradition by not doing theology. And also what I mean by theology is not just to look at, especially for those Muslim academics who have had a Western training, not just to look at Islamic sources, but to look at the connection, the global connection, the philosophical connection, the legal connection between different disciplines, between different forms of literature, between different ways of thinking, that intellectuals from all religions, no religions, all disciplines have touched on. And I think the best way to actually summarize this is the quote I gave on page 9, which is Gadamer's quote, "Our historical consciousness is always filled with a variety of views in which the echo of the past is heard. It is present only in the multifariousness of such voices. This constitutes the nature of the tradition in which we want to share and have a part." So I would say, even when I'm teaching students, I try to make them understand how the language that they might be reading in an Islamic text also has echoes in other disciplines, other religious texts, and to see that certain themes, what it means to be human, to talk of God, to talk of a transcendent, to talk of ethics, have echoes everywhere. Four of the chapters in this book are what I call traditional classical fiqh chapters. They're going through the text line by line, concept by concept, with my comments on them. Three of the chapters are what I would say are more theological in leaning. Chapter on the language of love in the Quran and the Bible, the language, the concept of evil, and what was the other one? Friendship. And friendship, I think, is really something that's been neglected in modern discussions on the good society. And I would say almost in the sense of religious freedom as well, by which I mean, does my religion allow me to be friends with everyone? Now, I think the answer might be to some people, obviously, of course it does. But what is a theological basis for that? Do we need to have a theological and philosophical basis? And I think, for me, the friendship one is particularly interesting because it seems to me that we have gone in the Islamic tradition from a scriptural basis for friendship, that you are friends only with those with whom you share a belief in God, those who are believers. Friendship is almost a political statement in early Islamic thought. To what you could say by the 10th century, that friendship is something that you have to seek. It's rooted in your search for God, and it's rooted in God. And that the 10th century scholar Miskawe wrote that friendship is something we need for human flourishing. But why do we need friendship for human flourishing? And what does it mean to live in a pluralist society where we have the freedom to be friends with everyone, but where I see friendship for certain Muslims is still a problem. What does it mean to share something with someone? What does it mean to befriend some with other people? And what does it say about your own faith when you are close to people of other faiths? And although I think people may not see it from that perspective, for me, it is a theological point. When I look at a Christian scholar, I've forgotten which university he teaches this, but Paul Waddell, some of you may have heard of him. He wrote that much of our lives is a history of our friendships. When someone stands in front of you, he wrote, you have the choice to either extend your hand in a hand of friendship or to ignore that person. And I thought about that, the history of our lives, so much of our lives is history of our friendships. And I think a lot of that is true because who we make friends with influences the way we think about so much. One small reflection on the chapter on dietary laws. Again, the reason I'm interested in these things is these things are what define Muslims in the West. They can't eat this, they can't drink that, they can't do this. And actually, it's not till you look at Islamic legal sources that you realize how lax the dietary laws actually are in Islamic thought. And that comes as a bit of a surprise. You know, it doesn't matter if that's not been slaughtered, just pick it up and say Bismillah and you can eat it. And today we've gone the other way, which is we've restricting so much to ourselves because it's not halal, whatever halal may mean in the modern day context. But to look at dietary laws in comparison to Jewish dietary laws is interesting because actually Jewish dietary laws are far more stringent than Islamic dietary laws. Now, in fact, I would say Islam hardly has any dietary laws other than the prohibition on pig meat. And again, even with pig meat, you can use the bristles. It's not that the pig itself is a contagious animal or a taboo animal. It's the consumption of the meat. Now, you may ask, how is that relevant? But I think it is relevant because I think, to me, it says that if scholars of the 8th to the 13th, 14th century were willing to discuss all these issues without being dogmatic in any way, what has happened in the Islamic world that we've lost that sense of discursive, hesitant, exploratory Islam and gone to a more dogmatic way of thinking about what Muslims should and shouldn't do? I'm just going to end on the kind of ethical basis for this. And I was very taken by one sentence in one of Muhammad Arkun's articles about the unthinkable and the unthought. And Arkun said that just because something hasn't been thought in the Islamic world doesn't mean it should remain unthinkable. And I think that is very true. But how do we get back to thinking about the unthinkable in a way that is discursive, hesitant, and full of humility, rather than dogmatic, prejudiced, and full of victory and triumph? So writing this book for me, to some extent, is that it's a book for, yes, it's for Muslim scholars, but hopefully it should also open the non-specialists to a way of thinking about a pre-modern Islam that is almost a lost world in the way that they talked about things. And so for me, the ethical imperative behind the book is to open up the arguments and to carry on with this kind of discussion in the Islamic world, which I think is theological, but not just a discipline that is a closed door. And just to say how this book will lead on to the next one, the next one is on the issue of hospitality. And by hospitality, I mean, who is a stranger today? Who are our neighbors today? How does the Muslim world, how do Muslims, whether they're in the West or in Islamic countries, talk about hospitality? And the reason this matters to me is, as you can see from the other book outside, is that so much of my personal life has been spent in Christian-Muslim dialogue, that I see that there are certain themes that Christian theologians have talked about that have just bypassed Muslim scholars. Why is it that these themes are important in Christian theology, but don't seem to have the same resonance in Islamic thought? Not in a kind of systematic way. I'm not saying the Muslims don't think about these things, but in a systematic way. And how do you go back to the tradition to open up that dialogue? I'm going to stop now and ask Charles to respond. Thank you.
It's not all that often that in the academic community one has the pleasure of reading a good book, meeting the author of that book, and then having the opportunity to discuss the book in public. So I'm very grateful for those three occasions being brought together. Before beginning, let me just say something to add on to what Professor Farr said by way of introducing us. If I'm not mistaken, one floor down is the Tocqueville Center, or has it been banished to some other place? All right, well then we'll forget that comment. At any rate, what I wanted to point out, if it's not too late, but Tocqueville is never out of place, is that religious freedom was a very big concern for Tocqueville. And if he remains somebody whom people in the United States look to for guidance, one really has to read what he says about Americans of the 19th century and their concept of religious freedom. But that's so much for a commercial that may be misplaced. What's delightful about this book is that it reaches out to and includes different disciplines as well as different faiths, and also raises questions that one almost never reads about being raised. Then when it does so in a very intelligent and gentle, appealing manner. Let me just give a couple of examples. And what I would like to do is to show what makes the book so appealing to me, raise a question about something that I wonder, its absence causes me to raise the question. And then I'd like to, if I could, suggest a correction to something the author. All right, thank you. To something the author said about the issue of evil. Of course, in this world, we have to always worry about evil. From the very beginning, Mona Siddiqui includes falsafa, philosophy, and tasawwuf, Sufism, along with the usual sciences of religion, of Muslim religion. Tafsir, as she translates it, exegesis, kalam, dialectical theology, or just simply theology, and fiqh. And what's fascinating is the emphasis that she puts on fiqh, normally understood as jurisprudence, but in the Quran, over and over, used in such a way that the verb's original meaning of to understand and to have awareness or knowledge of comes out. So those are the elements that are present. So for Mona Siddiqui, these five kinds of inquiry, philosophy, Sufism, Quranic or sacred text exegesis, theology, and jurisprudence are all literary genres that have to be explored. I find that very, very appealing. I also find appealing the gracious way she explains the book in the introduction as being a personal quest. And then as you read each of the chapters in the book, there's a little anecdote that opens it, that situates the question, that leads you into the question, and shows you why it is a very important question. In other words, this book is not an academic presentation of the field of Islamic law. And yet it is, when it's important. While I was trying to bring thoughts together for this, I was charmed by her references to my favorite or second favorite Islamic philosopher, Ibn Rushd, and his Bidayat al-Mujtahid. The use that is made of his book to explain certain things in The Good Muslim is very, very important and helps us understand much better when you follow that understanding that Mona Siddiqui puts forth. When you follow it through, it helps you understand what jurists like Ibn Rushd are trying to do. One question, however, nothing is said here about a issue that has, I think, become very prominent these days, maqasid al-shari'a. My question is a simple, open question. Why not? Is it perhaps not as important as those who pursue the field would have us believe? Now, in chapter 5, I have to look at the table of contents because I can't remember it now either. Islamic and other perspectives on evil. A lot of questions are put forth, and I'd like to say a couple things about them. Two thinkers are a number of thinkers are cited. The tour d'horizon that is presented is very, very appealing. But there are two who are not presented. Ibn Rushd is presented, but Abu Nasr al-Farabi and the man who thinks that he learned ever so much from him, Musa ibn Maimun, or as we know him, Maimonides. Let me just say a couple of things about what they say concerning evil to see if this might not sharpen the question more. In selected aphorisms, aphorism number 74, Al-Farabi declares, there is no evil. And let me quote the passage. Evil does not exist at all, not in anything of these worlds. And in general, in that whose existence is not at all due to human volition. Rather, all of that is good. That's the end of the quotation. It would seem to me that the clear implication then is that evil comes about from human volition. That's one issue. The second one is, I think that you bring up the question of Job, because this is what got me thinking about Job. Well, what about Job? Most of us raised in a Jewish Christian tradition, having read the Hebrew and Christian scriptures, are well aware of the problem of Job or the case of Job. And if we weren't aware of it, there was this marvelous playwright with his play, Job, so we could have caught it on Broadway otherwise. But for Maimonides, the issue is as follows. Job lacks wisdom. Wisdom. He lacks wisdom and knowledge. Moral virtue is not enough. That's a remarkable declaration. And so for Maimonides, the purpose of the book of Job is to explain how God's knowledge and providence differ from our knowledge and our awareness of providence. But he does this by arguing from natural phenomena. The wisdom that Job learns at the end of that story is not to question God or God's ways. He learns how insignificant he is in comparison to God, and above all, how little he can discern God's purposes. This is an age-old question, and you can put your finger on it anywhere you want. In the book, Munna Siddiqui goes back to Leibniz and the whole question of theodicy. And of course, there's that delightful little treatise by Voltaire, Candide, to call into question or to make fun of Leibniz's notions about justifying God. What is divine providence? How do we understand it? And it seems to me that one Quranic source for this whole issue, and it's one that I didn't find you alluding to, so I bring it out. Surat Qahf, Surat 18, and it's verses 60 through 82. Many of you remember the story very well. Moses meets somebody who's probably Al-Khidra and follows Al-Khidra along. Al-Khidra doesn't want Moses to accompany him and tries to belittle Moses, saying that you will not understand what I do. So Moses puts upon himself a vow of silence. He will not question what Al-Khidra does. The first thing he does is to find a boat moored to a dock and put holes in it so that the boat will sink, an act that Moses questions. The second thing that he does is to kill a young boy who seems to be just a sweet young boy who is innocent like all young children and shouldn't be killed. And the third thing he does is coming upon a city that's clearly a city filled with corrupt people and leaning against a wall that's about to fall down to insist that Moses and Moses' companion help him rebuild the wall. None of these things are clear to Moses. He questions each time. He receives an answer each time. And each time the answer shows how little we see as we look at things. The reason for drilling the hole in the boat was that otherwise it would have been seized by pirates and used for evil purposes. The reason for killing the boy is that had he grown to adulthood, he would have killed his decent moral parents. And the reason for building the wall is that underneath it was a treasure that belonged to two orphans. So the goal was to protect the treasure for those orphans until they would come of age. The ways of God are not known to man. Now, it's been the subject of a lot of commentary, and I'll close with the following. One of the most interesting commentators is Al-Maududi. Now, we all have our likes and dislikes concerning Maududi, but what he points out is that not one of these acts is an act that you or I, human beings, could do. And so Al-Khidra is obviously a being of a different order, an angel. This puts the whole thing into yet another realm. What is it that is incumbent upon us as human beings? Now, I don't know if you wanted to get people thinking along those lines, but this is an example of the way the delightful presentation of different texts in the book leads to thinking along with the author and then perhaps into questions that she didn't explicitly raise. So I'll stop there.
Thank you. I'll just make a very quick response and then you want to open it out to questions. The title of the book, The Good Muslim, was not my chosen title. Title was given to me by CUP, by Cambridge. My title was just going to be Reflections on Classical Islamic Law. But they said, no, we want you to... I said, you do realize I'm not defining what a good Muslim should look like. I'm just raising questions that a certain period in the Islamic world was not afraid to raise. And they talked about, and I'm trying to sharpen up those arguments by bringing them into a modern context. But they wanted the title. And one or two people have said to me after they've read the book, well, what does a good Muslim look like? And that's not the aim of the book. In the chapter on evil, what I was trying to get through, you're right, I've missed out Al-Farabi, but what I was trying to raise was not that God knows and we don't know the ways of God, but actually the difference in the concept of evil, theological and otherwise, between mainstream Christianity and mainstream Islam, and especially Sunni Islam, that to some extent Sunni Islam does not recognize evil as an ontological problem. It doesn't raise evil synonymously with the fall of Adam. In fact, I think Islamic theology is more about the fall of Iblis. And so therefore, sin and evil that I use quite coterminously in Islamic thoughts are sins and bad deeds, as opposed to sin that has to be overcome. And that then raises the question of the role of prophecy. Prophecy in Islam is not salvific. We are not saved through Muhammad, but you are saved through Christ. And that starts you to think about those very basic words that we use as if they mean the same thing in different religious traditions actually have a very different background, and also lead to different questions about how we think of eschatology, how we think of our life here, and how we think of our relationship to God. So the selection was not so much to say that we know anything other than what God knows, we don't, but how is it that when we say evil in a Christian Muslim context, or sin, we are actually talking about two quite different things. I'm going to stop there because I think you might want to ask questions.
Let me just, I think that's very, very important, the issue of the original sin in Christianity versus its absence in Islam. But I think now is the time to open
yes.
it.
Yes, yeah. I think we'll open the floor to question. I believe we are going to use this microphone, so.
Before we get to questions, by the way, I just want to say that copies of Mona's books, the current one that we're talking about right now, The Good Muslim, and her new book, Christians, Muslims, and Jesus, is on sale at a special event discounted price right in my office across the way from the back door. So please feel free to get a copy afterwards and have Mona sign it. If you want to raise your hand for questions and then just identify yourself and the organization that you're with, I'll come. And please just wait for the microphone.
Thank you. I'm Hannah Claus. I have no organization, but I'd like to know, what are these topics that Christians have addressed and Muslims have not? You've piqued my curiosity.
Richard Hyde. I'm with the Religion Consulting Group. And Mona, could you just talk a bit about Islam in the United Kingdom and the state of Islamic-Christian relations in the United Kingdom?
Sure, that's an easy one. I am Islam in the United Kingdom. It's really difficult. I mean, I think if you're talking about an academic discipline and dialogue between Christians and Muslims, the one area that I've been heavily involved in was building bridges, which actually is now sponsored through Georgetown. And Rowan Williams was very active in that. So when you have somebody at the high end active, it sends a trickle-down message to other people that there is an interest in this. There is an interest for theological reasons, for socio-political reasons, and for human flourishing. And we go back to the issue of religious freedom. What does it mean when Christians and Muslims talk about things that are of real concern to us? I think the way things have gone since 9/11, though, is that there are far more dialogue sessions which are about community cohesion, which are about bringing people together just so that they can come together and build a better community, rather than kind of theological, hardcore doctrine kind of discussions. So, and one of the reasons for that is, and one of the reasons why I wrote the Christians, Muslims, Jesus book is, even today, there are very few, and please feel free to correct me if I'm wrong here, but I think there are very, very few, perhaps no more than a handful, of Muslim scholars who have been trained in the West who are interested or can speak about Christian theology. And there are all sorts of reasons for this, but so, dialogue is always slightly stilted, if I can put it like that. Because a lot of Christian theologians who are interested in Islam are also Christian theologians, but also have Islamic studies, whereas they don't get that from the Muslim perspective. So depending on your intentions for entering into dialogue, you have to be prepared. Either this is just going to be, you know, nothing much, or it's good for what it is. Your question about, that leads me to your question about I think when I say that Muslims don't do theology, I think Muslims, as I say, distance. The tradition has been to write about, I mean, even if you think of the 9th, 10th century, the Mu'tazilites, they talked of God's justice, they talked of God's unity, and they were doing theology, they were doing kalam. But the way Christian theologians talk about God as an active participant in our destiny, and what it means to think theologically, I think that's missing from Islamic thought currently. It's not, confessional piety is one thing, but to talk about it in such a way that you open up the possibility. I'll give you an example. At one of these Building Bridges seminars, I was doing a discussion on human alienation. And I said that unlike Christianity, Islam has none of those defining moments when we are alienated from God, or when we are going to be reconciled with God, or that, we don't have those defining moments. But what does that say about God's reaching out to us, God reaching out? And if you read one of the most important themes of the Quran, it's on God's mercy. And there's so many anecdotes about, you know, don't tell my believing servants to stop sinning, because if they don't commit sins, upon whom am I going to bestow my mercy? And I said in my exploratory way of saying this, does God actually want us to commit sin? Is this God's way of needing us, or is needing too strong a word to say about God? And there was uproar from some of the Muslims because they said, you can't say God wants us to commit sins. As soon as you say you can't say anything, you can't explore an issue. And it doesn't have to be an issue that goes against mainstream Islamic thought. And even if it does, so what? You know, if the pre-modern thinkers were talking about everything, even God's unity, then why aren't we allowed to talk about these things today?
Peter Kovac, multiple affiliations. I'm a recovering religion major, and reflecting on Tom's initial remark about religious freedom as a variable in other social developments, I'm very troubled by the pattern you've laid out when a tradition, and I'm not going to say Muslim or Christian or any, a tradition goes from a discursive period to a dogmatic period. And asking all three of you who are scholars, do you see any patterns, outside social patterns that would predict that sort of a change historically?
Sorry, I don't understand what you mean by the end of that question.
Do you see any social predictors that would indicate that a tradition at an open and discursive stage is about to harden into more of a dogmatic stage in terms of discourse?
We had the example of that in Pakistan a couple of years ago when Salman Taseer tried to open up the debate about blasphemy law in Pakistan, and he was shot by one of his own bodyguards. Now, there is a primary example of somebody in a very high position. Now, you can say it's Pakistan, and you can make all kinds of excuses, but how safe are many Muslims to talk about these things in non-Islamic countries as well? I mean, I feel safe because I'm protected by the academy, but I think a lot of people who are saying some of those things that are controversial are only saying it in the West. But some people say, I'm only talking about the Islamic world. Some people say, if any change is going to come, it's going to come from scholarship in the West. But I don't know, because it's not just scholarship that can make the difference. It's all sorts of other factors, developmental issues, economic issues, political issues. So I don't know what the changes might be. But that doesn't mean that we don't talk about these things. Because if you don't talk about them, then how is change ever going to be brought about? And sometimes you do have to take risks, that if I say this, even in the West, that's going to have consequences. But in terms of religious freedom, my own anxiety is that for many people in the Islamic world, religious freedom is not a top priority. At least religious freedom of others is not a top priority.
If I could just add something. There's a marvelous film by Yusuf Shaheen called Destiny, which is about Averroes and the difficulties that Averroes went through towards the end of his life when a very dogmatic group came to power. I bring that up because when you read the way Professor Siddiqui talks about Averroes and his role as a jurist, you see a man who's trying mightily to balance a number of different traditions, schools of law, and attitudes towards doctrines, and to come through with what looks reasonable from within the religious perspective. Remember, this is the man who was known throughout the tradition. If you studied Averroes in college in the West, you've heard of him as being the creator of the two truth theory or the imposter. Well, I don't think that's accurate, but that's the way this man who tried to think things through came across. As a social scientist with my union card, I don't see social predictors. I would rather, I think, as an educator, think that those dogmatic tendencies are part of the early stage of thinking through a religion. As we know, not everybody gets beyond the early stage.
Hello, this is Utsa from World Hindu Council of America. My question is, since about 50% of the world's current Islamic population traces its origin to Hindu and Buddhist traditions around the world, what was the classical Islamic literature on non-believers or kafirs, and what is your opinion on it?
Say that one.
I'll say something, but you go first. I just came from a seminar in Paris on non-Western political thought. Somebody from India, Rajiv Bhargava, tried to explain how political thought in India has become modernized, and was very apologetic to a small group. We were only six people in a two-day seminar. Apologetic to us, but he'd also been apologetic in print about having to go back to Hindu and Buddhist sources to show this. And he also tried to explain, while going to those sources, that the even more helpful to him was the kind of Aristotelian rethinking that came through an Arabic/Persian tradition, Al-Tusi, and people like Al-Tusi who are commentators. So I would say there's a mix that one has.
I'm not sure I can add much to that. I need to think about that. I mean, when we talk about normative Islam, largely in the West, we're talking about the Sunni tradition and the Shi'as, if these are fixed traditions. But of course, when you go to certain parts of the Islamic world, there's all kinds of fluidity in thought that takes from other religions, a different kind of syncretism that we don't talk about in academic books. So I would actually need to do research on that. I don't know, truth be told, the extent of borrowing. I mean, you know, you can read the Mughal period and see how much some borrowed and some reacted to that borrowing. But the dialectic for me is interesting because I suppose behind your question is, at what point does a faith seize itself in a kind of syncretic way, that it's okay, the faith developed through borrowing and taking and tracing its roots back, or does a faith, for dogmatism again, say, enough is enough, we borrowed, or we need to reject that, we need to eject that out of our thinking. And I'm thinking about, I've lost my thread of thought. I was thinking about, Akbar in the Mughal period, who some Muslims defined as too syncretic, wanting to be too Hindu, and then his son with a backlash against him. This was taking Islam too far. But again, what causes that is interesting for me. What causes one person to be more expansive and the other person to say, this is a dilution of our religion? And at what point do we define what is the very core of a religion? But in terms of tracing back, I think it's a different kind of discipline that I'm not too sure about.
My name is Larry Rosano. I'm a pro-life activist for religious freedom and trying to combat the HHS mandate right now. In the core, getting at the heart of the problem, there's the Muslims, maybe it's just the Sunnis or the Shia, they believe in something that God said and that's it. And whereas, like Pope John Paul II made a book, you know, encyclical, whatever it was, Faith and Reason. In the Christian, maybe we don't know the reason, but we were, through revelation, things like that, we find out. Okay, in a sense, in a scientific way, we, you know, have different paradoxes and stuff like that. But when we learn more, we can understand why it happens. But on the other hand, the maybe it's the Sunni, but the Muslim perspective is, if God said it,
That said, it closes the whole thing. And doesn't that get the heart of it?
You need to read the book.
I would second that. I think the book shows you how a thoughtful Muslim works through that issue. Yes, one believes that God said it, but what did he say? What does it mean?
I'm David Little, a fellow here at the center. Hey. My question has to do with the relation between the two types of discussion, that is the discursive and the dogmatic, and the legal and political side. You might suppose that the discursive would lead to a more pluralistic legal political arrangement, and the dogmatic to a more autocratic form. Although I see nothing necessary about the connection, is there, in your view, a connection both ways in the Islamic tradition, and what would account for that?
If you look at, even a cursory look at the four schools, the traditional four Sunni schools of law, you realize that the larger school, the Hanafi school, is far more, they were criticized for using reason more than revelation in terms of how they developed their legal thinking. But part of the reason, and this is my, I don't think it's been refuted, but I would say part of the reason is the school developed largely in Iraq, which by that time or had always been a very cosmopolitan place. So schools that, thinking that develops in pre-existing pluralist societies creates a way forward for further pluralist societies. You have to deal with the political reality of being surrounded by people of all backgrounds. And how does a law or jurisprudence allow you to be in relationship with them? That's a political question as well as a theological one. I don't think you can separate the two. So, you know, for the Hanafis, all sorts of rights were given to, in personal law, marriage, divorce laws, to people of different religions that Muslims could engage with in a way that wasn't quite the same in one or two other schools, where the society was less cosmopolitan and perhaps developed in a different way, a kind of more pure thinking, if I can put it like that. But I think it's even within those schools, which are not Hanafi, it's the pluralism of thought. Going back to your question, that is interesting. This is my thinking. I'm sure a lot of people disagree. Were actually not interested in laying down the law. They were really interested in exploring the possibilities of the legal tradition. And they dealt with the Quran, they dealt with the prophetic words, they dealt with all the tools that they had. That's why there were differences amongst them. Now, you could argue, well, the differences aren't really that big. They're differences of, you know, small matters. It doesn't matter. There were differences. And I think the reason why Islamic law became to be seen as a queen of sciences in Islam, because ultimately law was about how do we reflect obedience to God. So you could do this, but you could also do that. But it might be better in that situation if you didn't do this. And today when we talk of Sharia, we think Sharia is, there's one answer to everything. And that's been, I think, the kind of tragic transition from law as a pluralist discourse to law as dogma.
Hi, my name is A.J. Nolte. I work here at the Religious Freedom Project at the Berkley Center. Professor Siddiqui, you mentioned, and I guess this is really a question for all three panelists as well, you mentioned the discursive period is really running from the 7th to the 13th century. And I remember way back at the beginning of my grad school days taking an Islamic political thought class in which the professor argued that really the sack of Baghdad in 1254 was a sort of pivotal moment in Islamic political thought and a real shock to the system for Islamic political thought. And I'm wondering if sort of given your loose identification of that period from the 7th to the 13th centuries, does it play a similar role in the transition for between discursive and dogmatic Islam, or is the transition perhaps at a different point?
Thanks. If I've understood you correctly, and interrupt me if I haven't, I think a lot of early Islamic discourse outside fiqh was political discourse. How does one live in plural? Remember, Islam developed in some ways in a pluralist landscape. Maybe not the kind of pluralism that we talk about today, but had to, from the very beginning, deal with people who were of different faiths. Whether it dealt with them nicely, generously, or badly, that's up to you to decide. But it dealt in some ways. It was a political reality. I think it's not so much that that was a rupture. I think the real rupture has come later than that, which is with the advent of colonialism. I think from which, to some extent, I think the Muslim world has never really got over. I think that has marked a kind of intellectual stagnation. And maybe you could argue that there was already an intellectual stagnation which made colonialism so easy, cultural colonialism, from which the Muslim world is still recovering, or whatever you want to say about that. But I think that has had, that's created far more of a rupture and a divide and a stagnation than the centuries previously. And I suppose the real question for me is, how do you recover that? How do you recover that without saying that dogma and a more fundamentalist interpretation of Islam is the way forward? There could be all sorts of reasons why it's difficult to recover that. We don't have the intellectual traditions. We don't have scholars who can discuss in the same way. We have traditionalist scholars. We have European scholars. But I think there's also a sense that there is no longer that openness to discuss things. And to some extent, I know it's a bit of a generalization, but I think there's a sense that when civilizations are comfortable, they can afford to be generous. When they're not, they tend to be defensive. And I don't know, I mean, this is a sweeping statement, I know, but I think to some extent, for all sorts of reasons, much of the Muslim world, and you know, the whole issue of religious freedom comes into that, is on the defensive. And that's why religious freedom has become a bigger issue now than it had been for many centuries in the Islamic world.
As somebody who does study political thought in Islam, I would just say that no, things did not come to an end in the 13th century or 13th century. I mean, after all, remember Ibn Khaldun, who is the beginning of the 15th century. There's something going on. And then what could have been said even 10 years ago can no longer be said today, because every day we're learning much more about the tradition. There are a lot of writers in the 14th, 15th, 16th, 17th century in the East whose works are now being uncovered and studied, presented, so that there is a whole new study going forward. The world of ideas is much bigger than we would like to believe, alas, but it is.
I'm going to go ahead and exercise my moderator rights and ask a question. Professor Siddiqui, you mentioned in your really excellent chapter on friendship, you mentioned actually in the presentation that perhaps friendship, do we need a philosophical or a theological basis for the practice of friendship? And my thought was that friendship is necessarily discursive, and that perhaps this is something that is going to happen in every culture and in every religion, however, and whether we like it or not. And I'm wondering if perhaps you would see, and Professor Butterworth as well, two questions. One, if that will provide some sort of way forward into seeing Islam as, once again, a discursive religion to some extent, rather than only fiqh. And secondly, what, and this is far too broad a question, but what is that relationship between the philosophical and the theological and the political and the mere practice of everyday friendship and political relations, and whether those two are tied in together? Sorry, it's too much to bite off in one question.
I think I'll just repeat what I said at the beginning, that I can't see how we can sever the friendships we formed from the history of our lives. They make us who we are. if I decide I don't want to be friends with somebody simply, I mean, I don't think I've ever thought of this in the sense that I can't be friends with that person because he or she's a person of a different faith. And yet I know people who do think like that. So it is a theological question, it's a political question, and it is a question of freedom. It is a question of religious freedom. What am I doing when I'm saying that it's okay to, not for any other reason, maybe, than for the pure reason of friendship alone? And the reason that the whole friendship chapter was interesting to me is because of the way it's been talked about, especially in the belles lettres literature of the West, Montaigne, Francis Bacon. And, you know, some of it's quite sexist as well, you know, that you cannot have a really good friend. Women cannot have really good friendships because they just don't have the soul and the spirit and the moral fiber. But men can. Men can have really strong platonic friendships. And these are men, you know, huge literary figures in their own culture and civilization. But they talk of friendship, which is not theological. They talk of friendship as that most intimate personal encounter you can have. And if you have an intimate encounter like that, it is going to affect the way you think about so many things. You wouldn't be human if it didn't affect you. So, you know, it's perhaps to some extent friendship has unintended consequences for our lives and our communities. And for me, that's the reason why it was important to raise it. Because from the early Islamic sources, friendship is seen as more of a political thing, a sociological tool to bind the initial community together.
I really enjoyed in your chapter on friendship the development of La Boétie and his Montaigne's relationship with La Boétie, and that's an essay that we all have to read in order to try to understand this phenomenon. Women and men, friendships. There was somebody who spoke to that, Rousseau, in his book Julie or the New Héloïse. And the relationship that goes on between Saint-Preux and Julie, they began as lovers, but it was a loving relationship that couldn't continue for external reasons, and they continued through life as deep friends. It's a beautiful portrait of how a man and a woman can interact. I'm fascinated by what you said in the book about it, because I think of a number of different Quranic verses. I mean, first of all, there's this verse that over and over and over people say, La ikraha fil din. There's no compulsion in religion. And there are Quranic verses that remind the person who might be worried that those who believe, that is to say Muslims, those who Judaize, those who are Christians, and Sabians, if they believe in God and the Day of Judgment and do good things, have no reason to be sad or to have fear. And a variant of this verse occurs two or three other times. It would seem that it's just all one big happy family. But of course, that's not simply so. That's the reason we have dialogues about getting along with one another. Surah 109 about I worship what I worship you worship, and so on, which seems to be a very tolerant surah, has a disconcerting title, Al-Kafirun. It's the title is those who reject belief, or however you want to translate that term. So how do we know what to do? And if the whole notion is radical monotheism in Islam, what do Trinitarian Christians do? I mean, that's a major problem. I think this is why we have these groups where we sit down and talk about our different beliefs. What you've done is to put all the material that one needs on the table, and then we have to work through it, I think.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Saba Ahmed. I do lobbying work at Capitol Hill, and I do deal with a lot of Islamic political issues here in the U.S. My question to you was about the intellectual discourse that we do have within our communities, how you deal with it, because oftentimes I feel like you get isolated and shut out if you do speak out against it, or if you just even want to question, well, this is not exactly what the Quran says. And especially as a woman, I'm very interested in your views about how you've dealt with it and how to your advice on just kind of dealing with it.
I have no friends. That's how I deal with it. I know it's a real question, and I think that I think if I was to cover my hair tomorrow, a lot of Muslims would listen to me. I think things have changed a little bit over the last 10 years, just by emails and requests I get, that there are more and more Muslims, I would say, of all ages, who are interested in advice and want to know things and want to be able to speak to somebody who isn't going to judge them straight away. But it's still a very male world. And it's still a very mosque-ridden world. It's still a very, the big names, especially converts to Islam, are the ones that dominate the political social discourse. I suppose the difference is I'm not necessarily saying to people, this is what you should do in order to be anything. I'm trying to say, why don't you just think about this in order to open your mind to different ways of thinking about something? So I'm not really, you know, it is a struggle. But then I think the imperative is that you keep saying what you think is right for the whole of society, not to see Muslims as some isolated community. And that just perpetuates their isolation and distinctiveness and the otherness even more. But to basically ask the question, as a citizen of the UK, what is my responsibility as a citizen? The Muslim comes second. And as a citizen, my responsibility is to create a better society in whatever way I can. And a better society has to be one that's more open and tolerant. Not tolerant to minorities, but where minorities are also aware of their responsibilities as British citizens, but always as people who have a different faith to the majority. And I think that one of the problems is, and maybe this touches on your initial question, is that there is no real literature in many parts of the world, for Muslims who are living as minorities and Muslims who need to think about what good citizenship means. There is political literature, but what does that mean in actual real practice? Not just to say, well, as you said, the maqasid al-sharia, this is what the good life is, but actually to be able to say, in order to engage in the making of a better society, I have to act like this. I have to be able to respond to questions like this. I can't carry on dodging certain questions because it's too awkward. And I think for someone like me, you know, as I say before, you're kind of protected by the academy. You should speak out. I think there's almost an ethical imperative that you speak out about issues. So just carry on doing what you're doing.
Thank you. My name is Hamza. I am a law student at Georgetown, also working for the Beckett Fund on Religious Freedom. I have so many intellectual questions I want to ask both of you guys, but I should probably stick to the one that my boss would want me to ask. and
Who's
that.
Your boss?
Asma. Okay, so as a scholar of Islamic text, if you were to speak to, you know, say the constitutional conventions in Tunisia or Egypt, where, you know, people are debating and grappling with these issues about religious freedom and what it means to, you know, protect Islam against, you know, the possible hazards of free speech, as, you know, we in the United States believe it should be. How do you, I mean, what are the kind of, what is it, maybe an Islamic-based argument, like, how would you, is there anything in the text, in the scholarly Islamic literature, that, you know, speaks to the freedom of speech, to the freedom of religions, to, you know, allowing people to speak their mind, even if, you know, they insult, you know, Islam, or if they insult the Prophet?
Sure.
Is there any argument that you could make, you know, that would be grounded in the Islamic history?
You're the political scientist.
We have to let Professor Siddiqui reply after I do, but I had the privilege two nights ago of being with a small group of folks having dinner and then having a long discussion with Sheikh Rashid Al-Ghanouchi, the founder of the Nahda party in Tunisia. For his efforts, he was thrown in prison and then had to seek asylum elsewhere. Two things that Sheikh Rashid said during the evening I thought were quite interesting. When he had to seek asylum, where did he find it? In the UK. He found people offering him asylum from countries that respect human rights. His fellow Muslim nations did not. And he's willing to make that charge. Okay. I mean, it's fact. That's one thing. Second thing is, he was very, very happy and shared with the people present his joy about what's going on in Tunisia, despite the ups and downs, which he sees many of them as growing pains, and he recognizes that they're, for one step forward, you might have to take two steps backward. If you think about any emergent nation, that's what happens. So that's what we're seeing. There may be social factors that explain the rise of Salafism. I don't know. But there's certainly a lot of people who are feeling, a new freedom that they didn't have, say, under Bourguiba or under Zayn Ali, and are expressing it, unfortunately, in a harmful way, and they have to be brought in. And there are others who are trying slowly to do the other thing. But what we, standing outside this force that's moving, I think really need to think about is that we, non-Muslims, non-North Africans, etc., need to give these people the time and the freedom to find their way. It's a slow process.
My question would be, if they chose to become more conservative in their thinking. So when people have the freedom to a more liberal state or more conservative, why do they choose a more conservative state or a conservative government? I'm not sure what's going to happen, but I think that when you're given the opportunity for a more liberal, free-thinking, liberally democratic state, or a state that gives you a kind of more Islamic veneer to things, a lot of people will still want the Islamic veneer. And for me, that's a real question. Why not go towards the more liberal? When in today's society, in some ways, everywhere you go West. You know, Western culture, Western everything, we're all Western. You know, those of us who are living here, we're all Western. So that's not a criticism, but what I'm saying is Western ideas of, I know this is a generalization, but liberal democracy and the software of democracies, freedom of expression, freedom of thought, freedom of conscience, is not necessarily that which engages so much of the Muslim world. That doesn't necessarily mean to say that they're negative towards it, but it just doesn't engage them. But for those whom it does engage, there's still a kind of dogmatism against it. And I don't know why that is. And I don't know whether it's just a religious hold, whether it's a political hold, whether there's other forces at play. But I don't know whether I share the same optimism as Charles, that give these people a chance and let's see what they come out with. I mean, at the grassroots level, people might feel more free, but constitutionally, there may still be a lot of restrictions to what you can and can't say.
But if I could just follow up a bit.
Then just going off what you said, would it be too simplistic to simply say that, you know, all of the Western ideals, freedom of thought, freedom of conscience, were the products of an enlightenment that hasn't happened in the Muslim world yet, and we need to just wait for that to happen? And if that's what you're saying, then how do we reconcile that with the fact that you've admitted at the outset that the Islamic world is in a period of dogma and not, you know, discursive action?
I mean, that's often raised by people, or, you know, when is the Muslim world going to have its enlightenment? I don't think that's the issue. I mean, the enlightenment came to the West, different political, historical contexts. The Muslim world is in a kind of political turmoil. It's not necessarily just an ideological turmoil, it's a political, and so in some ways, political and ideology and religion all go together. The ultimate thing is, do people feel safe? If you feel safe in being able to express what you want in the name of your religion, then you will feel safe in so many other ways. If you feel safe that you can talk about, you know, some of the recent issues around the Islamic world and feel that you're not going to be, your life isn't in danger because of what you said, then that means you're living in a very different society to the ones that we see so much, not just in the Islamic world, but also the kind of fear that we have by Muslims who live in the West as well, who are constantly making charges that what you've said is blasphemous or what you've done is against Islam. What does it mean to be against Islam? What does it mean to insult Islam? These are questions that people don't ask, but everybody takes it for granted that we know what that means. You can't say anything about the Prophet, that's insulting Islam. You can't say anything about the Quran, that's insulting Islam. You know, that would take up the whole intellectual tradition of Islam if everybody who spoke about something was seen to be insulting Islam. So this is why I go back and say, we need, I don't know which is first. You need the confidence to have the discussions, or you have the discussions hoping that ultimately will instill confidence? I don't know the answer.
Thank you. My name is Warren Kofsky. I'm currently at the State Department in the Office of International Religious Freedom, which was created about 13 years ago. I cover countries of the Middle East and lived in the Middle East with my wife and family for 20 years and studied at, did a master's in Arabic language literature at the AUC and had professors from Al-Azhar. I don't know how to say this succinctly, but I'll try. I'd like to ask a question about religious freedom and Islam. And the, I remember, well, one of the ways of defending the position in Islam that apostasy, irtidad or urida, prevents a Muslim from changing his or her religion is to say that there's a hadith that says whoever changes his religion, kill him. And that there are some Muslims, especially in the States or other places in the West, who point out in the what you might call discursive period that when that statement was made, that changing religion amounted to treason. So just to keep the question simple, did you see things in the discursive period which would prevent a basis for Muslims to have total freedom of religion, meaning including the sine qua non, which is the freedom to change, or would that be just possible through later times, say, the opening, what they call the Bab Ijtihad, to reinterpret or go back? And do you see any discussion among scholars today that gives an indication that that's being thought about? Thank you.
Thank you. I wrote a paper on this, apostasy and human dignity, in which I said exactly that the concept of rad and irtidad was, you change your religion in the fledgling Muslim community, it was an act of treason. It wasn't an act of conscience. That's how it was seen. And acts of treason were punishable in the West as well. It was a state thing as opposed to an act against God. But Muslim jurists and Muslim thinking, it's one of those things like intermarriage between male Muslim female and non-Muslim male, which should be discussed far more widely. Where is the evidence for this? But it came to be solidified very quickly in early Islamic thought as a way of keeping Muslims Muslims, as opposed to allowing them to marry, Muslim women to marry outside. And although on both issues, a lot of Muslim commentators today and scholars, especially in the West, legal jurists and scholars of Islam have talked about, I mean, well, Allah says there's no point in talking about Sharia. Sharia can never be revived in the way that it was talked about in that discursive period. I think he's probably right. We don't have the tools, we don't have the scholarship, we don't have the political context. But on the other hand, the principles of how people got to where they were in jurisprudence can be revived. And we don't have that because people go straight to the Quran or straight to a prophetic hadith and say, that's it. Well, if it was that easy, why did we have the legal tradition in the first place, if it was as simple as going to the Quran? So we need to revive that. But this is not actually known to a lot of Muslims. that Irtidad was specifically about treason, not about the right of conscience to change your religion. And I see that as one of the key problems in the Islamic world today, that hostility towards anyone who changes outside the Islamic faith is hostility tantamount to, you know, to a tragic fatality for most, in most cases. It's not just that the person is kicked out of the community, the person could be killed. Why aren't politicians, why isn't the state doing more about this? The state often speaks a good language on this, but it won't do anything about it. So, you know, again, where you don't feel safe, how can you speak about these issues? Maybe it's one of those things that people just can't get their head around. But then Muslims are very quick to say Islam is the fastest growing religion and we have so many converts. That's always seen as a good thing. Well, perhaps it is for some Muslims. But if you're going to say freedom of conscience, freedom of religion is an inherent Muslim right, then you can't just pluck out passages from the Quran and say, oh, there's freedom of conscience, no compulsion in religion. Actually, it's taken completely out of context, but used for religious tolerance and religious freedom. Just say that's it, that, you know, Islam gives you religious freedom. But actually, in all the early texts, religious freedom did not mean the freedom to change your religion in the way that we talk about it today. This is a very modern thing, because for the first, I mean, when I think of what Charles Taylor has written, he said, for the first time, religion has lost its public hold. And I think that's probably true, but perhaps not in Muslim societies. And if it's lost its public hold, that means religion, like every other thing, is a matter of choice now. And that's a very modern way of looking at religion. Because until the pre-modern period, you were born into a religion, that was it. But the ability, the desire to change, that's quite new. But again, I would say, because most Western liberal democracies have the software to deal with that, it works. With all the reactions people might have, but it works. But it doesn't work in so many Muslim communities because they don't have the initial software, that social context, in which something as dramatic as changing a religion is perceived as something that is a God-given right.
Thank you for your talk. My question is sort of on the other side of the coin of the questions that have been asked, which I'm wondering if, and I realize that you, Professor Siddiqui, are British and not American, but as the Muslim community grows in America, are there practices within Islam that would kind of go against kind of common cultural practices, which would cause the Muslim community to invoke the principle of religious freedom to be able to continue living out the life that they believe that God, Allah has called them to live?
What do you mean by that practice in Islam? I'm just trying to...
So actually, an example I read recently was that there was a conflict between two Muslim policemen and their police department because they wanted to continue growing out their beards, and the police department said that they had to, all the policemen had to be clean-shaven. Are there other instances or things of that nature that you could foresee coming down the pipeline?
You know, it's amazing how much appearance becomes an issue of conflict amongst religions, especially for the Muslim world. And that's one of my concerns, is that so much is about these things that one is kind of losing sight of the bigger picture. So, you know, you're spending all your time talking about the length of a beard, the length of a headscarf, and all the rest of it. Well, actually, you know, Nero fiddles while Rome burns kind of thing. I think these things do create conflict, but these things are very common in the UK as well. Examples of recent events is a school teacher wanting to wear a headscarf, where the school policy was that, or a full face veil, but the school policy was that she couldn't. And it's these kind of things that create a sense amongst the wider UK community that there's, that the Muslim world isn't just different, that it has different values. That, I think, is a real problem. Because if you start thinking that people have completely different values to you, then inevitably you're going to think, how on earth can we foster a common community? So either the Muslim world doesn't say anything, or when it says something that makes people think, hang on, we don't think like this, or this is the way we do things. And you know, in some ways, if diversity is going to be a good thing, it has to be negotiated with multiple voices, but multiple voices where people don't feel that they're coming to the table with individual agendas, that I'm of this community or this faith and therefore different from the very beginning. It has to be what is, to use a cliche, the common good here, within legal parameters. So the kind of things that you're talking about are very common in the UK as well. And although, personally, I think they're very small things, they're the things that are most damaging.
Hi, I'm Beth Neal with Department of State. And going back to what you were saying before about religion being seen in the modern world, in the Western world, as a choice and not something you're born with, if in Muslim-majority countries they perceive religion as something you're born to, how can we bridge that religious gap?
Well, I don't know if it's a gap to be bridged, because obviously one of the concerns in the Western world is also where is the place of faith in public life now? That if faith doesn't have a public hold, then how do people or religious voices, people who are against government policies on so many things, come out and say something? I mean, the recent gay marriage bills and all the rest of the discussions have been quite acrimonious to some extent. But I don't necessarily see this as a gap. I think this is a real issue of, in liberal democracies of the West, to an extent, and maybe the US is an exception, religion, public religion or institutional religion is on the decline. But popular religion in Islam is on the increase. And yet the argument is, for those who are of belief in Western democracies, is, so where does that leave me? They're filling their own gap here. They're trying to bridge their own gap here. If I don't have a say in the stake in society, then what, does that mean that my faith is just resigned to a private realm, whatever that may mean? And for many, they see that minority faiths, especially Islam here, because it's probably the most visible of all the minority faiths, is making its own demands and getting away with it. Now, I'm not necessarily sure that's true, but that's a perception, that when Muslims demand something in the name of their faith, they get it. When we Christians demand it, we have to take our case all the way to the European courts, you know, human rights courts, to get something. And then we often lose. You know, it was, I think, an Indian Catholic priest who said, Christianity has paved a way for leaving Christianity. And Islam hasn't.
I'll pull the typical graduate student move and recommend a book. Slavika Jakalic's book, Collectivistic Religions, I think is quite poignant to this. She's actually dealing, of course, with Eastern and Central European Catholicism primarily. But certainly of the idea of religion as something that you're born into that is not necessarily a choice. So I think it's certainly present. It is present, I think, within Catholicism, I think Protestantism as well. I don't know that it is a gap necessarily. I think perhaps, and I'm going out on a limb, but that it is much more a Western notion itself, that religion is, as with everything else, a choice individually, and that we have perhaps neglected the communal aspect of both religion and other aspects of our identity as well. Such that addressing religious freedom might, it might be worth looking at the freedom of the individual, but also at least a perceived freedom of the religious community, the libertas ecclesiae in traditional Christian teaching, and libertas personae. And that these categories, I think, can be helpful for addressing the perceived tensions and the real tensions.
My name is Farid Dosani. I'm just an interested bystander, a banker all my life and well retired now. My question is particularly for you, Dr. Siddiqui, or even Dr. Butterworth. Given the historical study you've made of Islam in various periods, to what extent has religious freedom then, and even now, what would you say, as academics, somehow been correlated with the economic situation at that particular moment? Somehow, I have nothing to, you know, my just guess would be that the more the society is economically doing well, the people in power and the society as a whole would probably tolerate more religious freedoms. And is there a correlation between the two?
I don't know enough research on that. On the outset, it would seem this is a logical way to look at it, that if a society feels economically confident, is stable, then it should feel psychologically, intellectually confident. But then take the example of Saudi Arabia. That's not a poor society. Now, whether it's just Salafism or Wahhabism or ideology or whether it's political control, you know, many parts of the Muslim world is, you know, religious freedom is not a concern for them in terms of crossing over to another religion. There's hardly any intra-faith diversity tolerated. That's another problem. So, you know, this is for the Saudis, very reluctantly, they will say that that the Shia are Muslims, many of them. I mean, of course, they can do the pilgrimage, but then there's a kind of tendency to. And in many parts of developed Islamic countries, there's all sorts of intra-Muslim conflict that takes place because, and I would go back and say, there is a sentiment still, a narrative of triumph in Islamic thought that I think is damaging the Islamic world. That the Muslim world has never, until the colonial period, the Muslim world was the ruler. It ruled, it mastered, it had empires all over the place. And it hasn't developed. And that was a triumphalist discourse in all kinds of literature. But again, then the post-colonial period, where the Muslim world is no longer the triumphalist empire. What kind of thinking do we need in order to be, not just cope with religious pluralism, but also how you migrate to different countries and live within legal pluralisms, not just social pluralisms? This is why I think law is still the most important thing in the Islamic world. Law, jurisprudence, however you define it, how do you create and continue with that discursive dialogue of what it means to live as a member of a wider community, not just a Muslim community?
One more question.
I'm Timothy Shaw, Associate Director of the Religious Freedom Project. How marvelous to host this wonderful discussion. Thank you to all of you. One issue over which there's worry that there may be a conflict between, as it were, the vision of being a good Muslim and religious freedom is Sharia law. There is clearly a great deal of misunderstanding in the West, a great deal of even of hysteria in the West about Sharia and its demands. You may know, Mona, that I think at least a couple of American states have actually considered, or in one case, Kansas passed an anti-Sharia law measure. And as you well know, Mona, after former Archbishop of Canterbury Rowan Williams talked rather favorably about using Sharia law in private arbitration in the UK, there was a great deal of controversy. If I may, of course, there's now, in the last couple of weeks, a great deal of horror about the statement of Michael Adebolajo after murdering the British soldier in England last week, in which he, as it were, seemed to invoke Sharia, not as Sharia, but invoked verses of the Quran to justify what he did. What do you say, as a scholar of the Islamic tradition, to, I think, what clearly is a widespread, sometimes not articulate, inchoate worry about Sharia in America, in the UK. You have played an admirable role in trying to shape public discourse on these matters. And so I think many of us are wondering about these issues as we speak, and I'd be wonderful to have you say whatever you'd like about this whole nexus of worries and controversies.
I mean, I think Sharia has become a shortcut for everything that's wrong with the Muslim world in the West. You know, you say the word Sharia and people, you know, the hairs on their spine go up. But I think, you know, going back to Rowan Williams, this is the extent to which people are afraid of the world. And the media is to blame for this. I mean, I work in the media, but on this occasion I will blame them. That they hadn't even heard what he'd said. They hadn't read what he'd said. And he wasn't saying that we should have a parallel legal system and that Sharia law is great. He was saying that where you have people in some areas with particular religious demands, how do you create a society for the good of all where those, where certain aspects of their faith can be accommodated? Now, if you think about it, they already are. I mean, Sharia law to most people means you can't show your face, you know, stoning of adultery, and that's it. But the whole of the fiqh tradition is an attempt to try and understand what is God's law without ever actually saying this is God's law. But Muslims marry according to Sharia law. They can divorce according to Sharia law. If they're not drinking alcohol, that's Sharia law. If they have dietary requirements, that's Sharia law. None of that is an imposition on the legal system. But because people don't want to debate what is actually meant by Sharia law, Muslims and non-Muslims, let me add, that creates that problem. I didn't know that there was an anti-Sharia law law, which is really interesting. So what is it that they can't do that they would have done before the law?
Nothing in court.
You can't. The model legislation upon which it's based says that you, it's called American law for American courts. You may not utilize foreign law, which would include Sharia, to the extent that it would violate constitutional rights and privileges.
A recent example of that in the UK was an Egyptian man who'd married a Scottish woman. They had two children. And she had said to him, they had agreed that the children were brought up as Muslims. She had converted to Islam. But then they divorced. And she wanted custody, children quite young, she wanted custody of the children. And the man said, according to Islamic law, and also by our premarital agreement, she said that the kids would be brought up Muslim, and also that I would have custody according to Islamic law. Because I think he was Egyptian. But anyway, that he would have custody. But Scots law ruled against it, said that the woman does not have to bring them up as Muslims. That's according to your law or your thoughts. She can bring them whatever religion she wants, and also the kids will stay with her until the age of, and you will have to provide maintenance. The papers went, what does that mean? But the Scots law was right. You can't have, somebody saying that I have a separate religious system and that has to be. My comment on that only was for the sake of the children, the two should come to some kind of good compromise. But as a legal discussion, the conclusion was right, I think. Because otherwise, people can start making all kinds of demands in the name of religious law. Then where would you end that? Because religion itself is disputed, religious law is disputed, the way people practice a religion is disputed. How on earth are the courts going to make sense of individual demands? He's a convert. He obviously wanted to make an impact, and these are the kind of ayahs that are fed into converts. And they become I'll be absolutely honest here. I have seen some of these jihadi videos in a few cases I've been involved in, and some of them are so mesmerizing that you think if somebody's watching this, for whatever reason, broken home or feeling disconnected or feeling alone or feeling, what's at stake here, you could so easily get sucked into that. And that's not a defense or a justification, but it's just so hard to try and kind of get into that world as to what makes somebody switch on a jihadi video or a jihadi clip, what makes somebody get completely sucked in, and then from that to actually take an action. I don't think we're there in trying to work out how these three steps take place.